Now, let us try to derive the equation of a circle that passes through three non-collinear points z1, z2 and z3. So, let us say we have A represented by z1, B represented by z2 and C represented by z3 be three non-collinear points. So, let us draw a circle which passes through these three points. See, this is my circle that passes through z1, z2 and z3. So, this is my point A, z1, this is B, z2 and this is C, z3. See, this is the center of the circle. Let us take one more point P, represented by any by complex number z that even lies on this circle. So, when I join these two, joining z1, z3 and z3, z2, I am again joining z1, P and z2, P. So, now as per the property of this triangle, this angle ACB is subtended by this arc AB and this angle APB is even subtended by this arc AB. So, as per the property of circle, these two angles have to be equal, which is equals to theta. Now, one more thing, theta is the angle between these two lines BC and AB and AC. So, by Conneaut theorem, I can write z3 minus z1, z3 minus z1 upon z3 minus z2 as AC upon AB into e to the power iota theta, where theta is this angle. Similarly, I can write z minus z2 upon z minus z1 as PB upon AP into e to the power iota theta. Once again, what I am telling is I can write z3 minus z1 upon z2 minus z2 as mod of AC upon AB into e to the power iota theta, and similarly I have done that for z minus z2 upon z minus z1, because theta is nothing but the angle between these two lines and here it is the angle between these two lines. So, we have used the property equation that we have derived for angle between two intersecting lines. When I divide 1 and equation 2, what I get is z3 minus z1 upon z3 minus z2 into z minus z1 upon z minus z2 is equals e to the power iota theta, e to the power iota theta bit will cancel. What I will get is AC upon AB into AP upon PB. These are all modulus because these are all the lengths of these line segments. So, I can even replace this complete term by any real term. So, I say z3 minus z1 upon z3 minus z2 into z minus z1 upon z minus z2 will be equal to some real term, or I can even say that argument of z3 minus z1 upon z3 minus z2 into z minus z1 upon z minus z2 would be equal to 0 or plus minus pi, because this complete term is equals to a real number. Now, if I replace this z by one more complex number z4, then I can define the condition for two points z1, z2, z3 and z4 to be co-cyclic. That is, for four points z1, z2, z3 and z4 to be concyclic, what we can write is z3 minus z1 upon z3 minus z2 into z4 minus z1 upon z4 minus z2 should be equals to some real number for 4 points z1, z2, z3 and z4 to be concyclic. This is the condition that we have defined for 4 points to lie on the same circle. So once again, what we did was we draw a circle that was passing through these 3 non-collinear points, and we took one more point z1 that was lying on this circle. Then we applied the formula of property for intersection of two lines, and we wrote these two equations. Solving this, we got was that the multiplication of these two vectors, these two complex numbers, is always real. That is, their argument is going to be 0 plus minus pi, and we just replace z by another complex number z4 here, and we derive the condition for 4 points z1, z2 and z3 and z4 to be concyclic. So we have derived one more equation for circle based on 3 complex number. Now the next thing that we are going to derive is the equation of a circle based on the coordinates of its diameter. For example, if we are given a circle which has the diameter z1 and z2, we have to derive the equation of a circle based upon it. Let us see how we can derive. Do you all remember the very common property of a circle? That is, the diameter of a circle subtends an angle of 90 degree on the circle. We are going to use the same equation, same property for deriving the equation of a circle in case of complex number. So let us call this as diametric equation of a circle. Diametric equation of circle. To start with it, let us say we have a circle. This one seems to be like a circle. Let us say we have a circle which has diameter z1 and z2, and let there be any point P, z, which lies on this circle. So when I join z2 and z1, I get this angle, and as per the property of circle, which says that the diameter subtends an angle of 90 degree on the circle, I can say this angle is 90 degree. This implies P, if this is point A and this is point B, then I can say that PA and PB are perpendicular. So I can even say that the summation of complex slope of this line and this line is going to be 0. Once again, I know that this PA and PB, this angle APB is 90 degree. This implies line PA and PB are perpendicular. So this even means that the summation of the complex slope of this line PA and PB is going to be 0. This is something we studied by studying the condition for two lines to be perpendicular. So I say, so we can write the slope of PA as z minus z1 upon z bar minus z1 bar. The slope of PB would be z minus z2 upon z bar minus z2. And we know that since these two lines are perpendicular, the summation of their complex slope would be 0. So I can write this as 0. When I solve this equation, what I get is z minus z1 into z bar minus z2 bar plus z minus z2 into z bar minus z1 bar is equals to 0. This is the equation of a circle in diametric form. Next thing what we are going to derive is the general equation of a circle which is orthogonal to two circles. Next we are going to derive the equation of a circle which is orthogonal to two circles. Before that, let us first define when the two circles are said to be orthogonal. For example, I have one circle with center C1 and radius R1. And I have another circle with center C2, my circle with center C1, and this is my circle with center C2. This circle has radius R1 and this circle has radius R2. For these two circles to be orthogonal, this angle has to be 90 degree. That is, these two circles are orthogonal if C1 C2 square is equals to, this is R1 and this is R2, C1 C2 square is equals to R1 square plus R2 square. Once again, these two circles would be orthogonal when the distance of their center, when the square of the distance of their center is equal to the summation of the square of their radius. That is, C1 C2 square is equal to R1 square plus R2 square. This is the condition for two circles to be orthogonal. Now let us try to find the equation of a circle which is orthogonal to two circles Z minus Z1 equals to R1 and Z minus Z2 equals to R2. So we have been given two circles, one is Z minus Z1 equals to R1 and the second is mod of Z minus Z2 equals to R2, that is the center of this circle is Z1, radius R1 and the center of this circle is Z2 and the radius is R2. We have to derive the general equation of a circle which is orthogonal to these two circles. Let us say the general equation of this circle would be something of the form mod of Z minus alpha equals to K R. Okay. Let us say this is the general equation of that circle. Now we know that first these two circles are orthogonal. So based on using the property of two circles being orthogonal, I can write summation of the distance between their center would be Z1 minus alpha. The square of this distance should be equal to the summation of their radius, that is R1 square plus R square. This is our first property. And we even know that these two circles are orthogonal. So applying the condition of orthogonality on these two circles, what we get is Z2 minus alpha whole square is equals to R2 square plus R square. When I try to solve both these equations, what I get, what I am doing is I am subtracting equation 2 and equation 1. What I am going to get is alpha into Z1 bar minus Z2 bar plus alpha bar Z1 minus Z2 plus mod of Z2 square minus mod of Z1 square is equals to R1 square minus R2 square. So this is the general equation of a circle which is orthogonal to two circles Z minus Z1 equals to R1 and Z minus Z2 equals to R2. Let us solve one question so that we can understand, we can understand how to apply this equation. Now let us say we have to find the general equation of a circle which is orthogonal to these two circles. Let us say the first circle is mod Z equals to 1. This is a circle whose center is 0 and radius is 1. And the second is mod Z minus 1 equals to 4. This is a circle with center 1 and radius equals to 4. So let us say the equation of a circle would be something of the form mod of z minus alpha equals to k, where alpha would be the center of the circle and k is going to be the radius of our circle. Now applying the condition for orthogonality, we have these two circles as orthogonal. So I can say alpha minus 0 square is going to be equal to 1 square plus k square. I can write this as mod alpha square is equal to 1 square plus k square. And this mod z square is equal to z into z bar. I can write this as alpha into alpha bar is equal to 1 plus k square. This is what I derive by applying the first condition of orthogonality. This is the second condition that we have to apply. Based upon this condition, I can write alpha minus 1 alpha minus 1 whole square is going to be equal to k square plus 4 square. Again, this is alpha minus 1 into alpha minus 1 conjugate equals to k square plus 16. I hope everyone is comfortable with this. The distance between the center of these two circles is going to be a mod of alpha minus 1. Its square is equal to k square plus 4 square. This is 16. Now I know alpha minus 1 conjugate would be equal to conjugate of alpha minus conjugate of 1, which is 1. Since a plus b conjugate is equal to a conjugate plus b conjugate, I have applied the same property here. Expanding it, what I get is alpha alpha bar minus alpha plus alpha bar plus 1 is equal to k square plus 16. This is the second equation which I have derived using the property of orthogonality. Now from this equation I already know that alpha alpha bar is 1 plus k square. So I can put 1 plus k square here minus alpha plus alpha bar plus 1 is equals to k square plus 16. K square get cancelled, so I get alpha plus alpha bar is equals to minus 14. This is what I get. Let us say alpha is of the form a plus iota b. So alpha plus alpha bar is nothing but twice the real part of A, which is equals to 2A, which is equals to minus 14. So from here I get A is equals to minus 7, which is the real part of alpha. Now from this equation I even know that K, I know is mod of alpha square is equals to 1 plus k square. This is what I know from the first equation that we had derived by applying the condition of mod z equals to 1 and mod z minus alpha equals to k being orthogonal. So from here I can write mod of alpha square would be nothing. If alpha is a plus iota b, then this is going to be a square plus b square. This is equals to 1 plus k square. We already know that a is equals to minus 7. So this is equals to 49, that is 7 square plus b square is equals to 1 plus k square. From here we get k is equals to 48 plus b square under root. So we have a circle whose radius is 48 plus under root b square and whose center is minus 7 plus iota b. So we have derived the general equation of a circle in form of this parameter b. So this almost completes our discussion related to finding the general equation of a circle in case of complex number. So the first thing that we saw was we can always write the general equation of a circle in case of mod of z minus z naught equals to r, using the definition of a circle where z naught is the center and r is the z naught is the center and r is the radius of the circle. The next thing that we saw was how we can write the general equation of a circle for complex number, which was zz bar plus az bar plus a bar z plus b equals to 0. And the most important thing in this equation was that the conjugate of zz bar, that the coefficient of zz bar in this equation is always 1. So whenever we get an equation of this form, in order to convert it into the general equation, we have to make the coefficient of z into z bar as 1. For this general equation, the center of the circle was minus a and the radius was mod of a square minus b under root. Then we saw how I can derive the general equation of a circle which passes through 3 non-collinear points a, b and c. And using the same equation, we derive the condition for 4 points A, B, C and D to be concyclic, that is to lie on the same circle. Then we even saw that if we have a circle whose diameters are given, we can derive its equation by using the property that this diameter subtends an angle of 90 degree, and the equation in this term, in this case, turned out to be Z minus Z1 into z minus z2 bar plus z minus z2 into z minus z1 bar was equals to 0, and we call this as the diametric equation of a circle. Last we saw that how we can derive the equation of a circle which is orthogonal to two circles. We even discussed the question based upon this. Now, let us try to define some locus of a point in case of complex number. The first what we are going to define is the equation for a parabola, which is the locus of a point whose distance from a fixed point, which is called the focus of the circle, and whose distance from a fixed line, which is called the directrix of the parabola, is C equal. Now, let us start discussing equation for a parabola in case of complex number. Even before starting the equation for a discussing equation of a parabola, I have just forgotten to mention two points in case of equations for a circle. Let us first discuss those two points and then we will proceed on to equation for a parabola. So, the first point that is related to equation for a circle in case of complex number is, if I have any equation of the form mod of z minus z1 upon mod of z minus z2 is equals to k, then this equation is going to represent a circle if k equals to 1. Sorry, if k is not equals to 1. Once again, if I have any equation of the form mod of z minus z1 upon mod of z minus z2 equals to k, then if k is not equals to 1, this equation is going to represent a circle. And if k is equals to 1, this equation will represent a straight line. Let us see how. If I put k equals to 1 here, what I will get is mod of z minus z1 equals to mod of z minus z2. This is nothing but the equation for the perpendicular bisector of a line which joins z1 and z2. This is how we can prove that if k equals to 1, this equation represents a straight line. The second one is, if I have any equation of the form mod of z minus z1 whole square plus mod of z minus z2 whole square is equals to k, then this equation represents a circle if and only if k is greater than half of mod of z1 minus z2 whole square. Once again, if I have an equation of the form mod of z1 minus z2 whole square plus mod of z minus z1 whole square is equals to k, then this equation will represent a circle if this k is greater than half mod of z1 minus z2 So equation is going to represent a circle. I'm not really stating proof for these two properties because it is not very important, not with neither with respect to JE nor with respect to CBSE or any other exam, but I'll just ask you to remember these two properties. These might be useful in some situations. We'll try to solve some questions even based upon this these two properties. So as of now, this almost completes our discussion related to circle. And now let us go and discuss our next topic, that is equation for a parabola for complex number. Let us first, so we have already discussed what is the definition for a parabola. A parabola is basically a locus of a point whose distance from a fixed point, which is called the focus, and whose distance from a fixed line, which is called the directrix of a circle, is always same. So let us try to draw a parabola on the Argand plane. For example, this is my fixed point represented by a plus iota into 0. This is the focus of the parabola, and this is a straight line which is the directrix of the circle, which is represented by z plus z bar plus 2a is equals to 0. Let us take any arbitrary point P of z which lies on this parabola. Now as per the property of the parabola, this distance, which is the distance of this point from the focus, has to be equal to this distance, that is the distance of this point from the directrix. Now using distance formula, I can always write this distance is equals to mod of z minus a plus iota 0. And using the formula for perpendicular distance of a point from any line, here z is that point and z plus z bar plus 2a is the line. Using that formula, the distance is going to be z plus z bar plus 2a upon mod of 1 plus mod of 1, which is equals to mod of z plus z bar plus 2a upon 2 is equals to mod of z minus a. Once again, what we have done is we have equated these two distances. So using the distance formula, I can say that this distance would be equal to mod of z minus a plus iota 0, and this distance would be equal to z plus z bar plus 2a upon mod of 1 plus 1, that is 2. When I solve this equation, I get something of this form: z into z bar minus 4a z plus z bar is equals to half of z square plus conjugate of z bar. This is the general equation for any point z which lies on the parabola in case of complex number. Once again, what we studied was a parabola is a locus of point whose distance from a fixed point, which is the focus of the parabola, is equal to the distance from a fixed line, which is called the directrix of the parabola. In this case, our focus is a plus iota 0 and our directrix is this line z plus z bar plus 2 equals to 0. Then we equated these two distances and we derived the general equation for the parabola of just one really important point to remember: we have derived this equation considering the fact that the focus of this the parabola would be a plus iota 0 and the directrix would be z plus z bar plus 2a equals to 0. So whenever the directrix or the focus change, this general equation will also change accordingly. So whenever when we solve a question based on parabola, we'll just have to take into consideration. Now let us discuss another topic, that is equation for an ellipse in case of complex numbers. Now let us discuss equation of for ellipse. So let us call the topic as equation for ellipse. Now we all know that the ellipse is defined to be a locus of point, the sum of whose distance from two fixed point which are called the focus of ellipse is always constant. So let us first draw an ellipse. I say this is my ellipse, and as per the property of an ellipse, any point which lies on this ellipse, the sum of its distance from two fixed points would be always constant. So for example, this is S and this is S dash. Let S be Z1, S dash be Z2. These are the two focus of the ellipse. Let there be any point P represented by Z which lies on this ellipse. So as per the property of ellipse, the sum of this distance SP and S dash P always has to be constant. Let us say equals to 2A in our case. So I can say as per the property of ellipse, SP plus S dash P would be equal to 2A. Find here is SP plus S dash P would be equal to 2A. As per the property of ellipse, I can write SP as mod of Z minus Z1, S dash P as mod of Z minus Z2. This is equals to twice of A, where 2A is going to be greater than Z1 minus Z2, because eccentricity in case of ellipse is less than 1. This is all we know from basic knowledge of coordinate geometry. So this is the general equation for an ellipse in case of complex numbers, where we define that SP plus S dash P would be always equals to 2A. And this is the equation for ellipse where A is always going to be a positive real number. So this is how we can define equation for an ellipse. Next we are going to define an equation for hyperbola. So unlike ellipse, a hyperbola is basically a locus of point. The difference of its distance from two fixed points is always constant. This equation for hyperbola. So let us draw an hyperbola first. These two has to be symmetric, so I draw it this way. This is my first focus, S dash, represented by Z1. This is another focus, S, represented by Z2. And this is any point P which lies on this hyperbola. Now as per the property of hyperbola, the difference of its distance from two fixed point is always constant. Thus I can write SP minus S dash P is always going to be constant, and let us say this is equals to 2A. So I can always write mod of Z minus Z1 minus mod of Z minus Z2 will be equal to 2A. In this case, Z1 and Z2 are the focus of the parabola, And then since for a hyperbola, eccentricity is greater than 1, we can write 2a would be less than mod of z1 minus z2. Once again, I am going to let us discuss how we define the general equation for hyperbola. We said that hyperbola is nothing but the locus of a point whose distance from two fixed points is always constant. Using that, we wrote sp minus s dash p is equals to 2a, which is equals to mod of z minus z1 minus mod of minus z minus z2 is equals to 2a. And since the eccentricity of the hyperbola is always greater than 1, we can write 2a is less than mod of z1 minus z2. Here a belongs to R plus, that is positive real numbers. So this is how we can define equation for a parabola, ellipse and hyperbola in case of complex number. So what we have seen till now is the way we could define any locus, equation or general form, general equations or special cases in terms of real number. All the same things we can define in case of complex number. So I may even say that all the coordinate geometry that we have discussed till now for real numbers, all the same things even apply in case of complex numbers, and which has to be because we have already said that complex number is a superset of real number, that is this complex number even comprises of real numbers. So in today's lecture we studied how we can define the general equation for a straight line in case of complex number. We even tried to define condition for collinearity, for two lines to be perpendicular, for two lines to be parallel. We even defined equation for a circle in different terms, and we saw how we can derive equation of a circle in terms of a diameters, in terms of three non-collinear points, etc. I hope everyone would have noted this. Then we even saw how we can define equation for a parabola, hyperbola and ellipse in case of complex number. With this, we have almost discussed all the theory which is related to complex number. From the next lecture, we are going to discuss lots of problems or applications based on complex number. So, what we will do is today, I will distribute you the complete question package related to complex number. The package contains some theory related to complex number, especially some of the important properties that we had noted down. Plus, it is going to include lots of problems related to complex numbers. It will contain questions based which were discussed in last IITs, maybe in main screening, plus some of the questions which are discussed in CBSE board examination, and lots of questions from most from really good books. And which will based upon that questions, we will try to once again revise plus apply all the concepts that we had studied in complex number. So today you all will get the package related to complex number, and from the next lecture onwards we are going to discuss questions related to complex number. So what we can do is let's say in every lecture we will discuss about 8 to 9 problems. And we'll note down the problem numbers beforehand, which we are going to discuss in the next lecture. That when you come in the next lecture, you come prepared for all the questions, and you can try a hand on those questions before, and all the doubts even that you get related to those questions, we'll discuss in the lecture. One more thing that we'll try to is we'll try to solve the same question in 2 or 3 different ways, and we'll try to see which way of solving the question would be the best. Because when we are trying to prepare for an examination like J or even AIEEE, in that case what we have to focus is not on just solving the question rightly, but we even have to take care of the time that we take in solving the questions. So we will try to solve the same question in 2 or 3 ways, sometime using the complex representation, sometime maybe by polar representation, sometime maybe by exponential representation. And we will try to see which way is fastest in what type of situations. So as of now, let us end this lecture today, and from next lecture onwards we are going to discuss all the problems based upon complex numbers.